In this section, we'll look at antipsychotic medications. Now, they go by other names, neuroleptics, dopamine antagonists, or serotonin-dopamine antagonists. They all work in the brain. What we're trying to treat with these medications are schizophrenia, bipolar, major depression, and delusional disorders. If your patient is having hallucinations or delusions, as a nurse, your job is to validate that what they're feeling might be scary, might make them angry, but that it's not real. So in a textbook situation, you can say, "I'm sure that is scary for you or feels uncomfortable for you, but I don't see what you're seeing." Now, with schizophrenia, these patients can have a real flat affect. They can be apathetic. They can kind of withdraw. They also have challenges with delusions and recognizing reality from what they're seeing in their mind. Now, there's first generation, which we call conventional, and there's also second generation. But I want to talk to you first about the first generation. You've got the names listed there. And again, I know I keep reminding you, but I want you to recognize you have to know the generic names. Names inside the parentheses are the trade names put there for your convenience, but they won't be present on the NCLEX. So the adverse effects of first generations, they tend to have more adverse effects than the second generations. These are the drugs we discovered first, which is why they're the first generation. So you can have these extra pyramidal symptoms. I'm sure you had these in your psych classes, but we're talking about acute dystonia, pseudo-Parkinsonism, where they're shaking, akathisias, where they just can't really be still, and tardive dyskinesias, these kind of weird tics. So you take somebody who already has some challenges with a mental health diagnosis, and they might end up with some of these symptoms that are going to be less than helpful in them coping with daily life. Now this one, neuroleptic malignant syndrome, whoa, that one needs to be circled. That can be life-threatening if it's not treated. They can also have anticholinergic effects, dry eyes, dry mouth, urinary tension, dry stool so they get constipated. Those can be bothersome, but they're not life-threatening like neuroleptic malignant syndrome. Also, just like the sedative hypnotics, these can also cause orthostatic hypotension. But don't miss out on that neuroleptic malignant syndrome that has an arched back, lead pipe rigidity, and the patient could die usually from respiratory failure, but the patient could die without treatment. Now, antipsychotics are neuroleptics or serotonin-dopamine antagonists. We told you they go by different names. We've got names of the first generation there that you've already seen. Now, I've given you some atypical second-generation antipsychotics. So come back and spend some time with those names so you remember them. Now, these cause few to none of the extrapyramidal symptoms we talked about with first generation. Sweet! That's because the second generation is usually better. So those are the symptoms, but they're going to less likely to have them with a second generation antipsychotic than a first one. The exception to that is clozapine. You can have severe adverse effects like agranulocytosis. They have an increased risk of serious metabolic effects like weight gain, diabetes, and dyslipidemia. Wow. So why would we use that medication? Well, hey, CNS medications are really tricky, and this may be the one medication that works effectively for your patient, so we're going to use it, but knowing what these risks are, we're going to keep an eye out for those and help the patient manage those. So clozapine has some pretty unusual risks. As you can tell, that's going to be an area ripe for test questioning possibilities. Nobody knows for sure, except the people who create the test, but you don't know what's going to be on your test, but this is an area where you would need to recognize that a patient was at risk for their safety. Because this agranulocytosis is a big deal. It's dangerous. It's a really low white blood cell count, or leukopenia. So granulocytes, including the neutrophils, the basophils, and the eosinophils, are less than 5% of normal, commonly the neutrophils causing the neutropenia. So clozapine has a big problem with agranulocytosis. We just defined that for you there in case that word was unusual to you or unknown to you, but it is severe. So when clozapine is needed, it's a good alternative. However, you have to be on alert and monitor for agranulocytosis. So you have to know normal CBC values so you would recognize when they're abnormal. Now, neuroleptic malignant syndrome, we touched on it a little bit, but remember, it's a life-threatening emergency. They have that lead pipe muscle rigidity, extreme extramural symptoms. Their temperature is very, very high, heading way, way up. They have high blood pressure. Their heartbeat is going very, very fast. So if you want to be thinking about what's a big overarching theme, it's like sympathetic nervous system overdrive. Blood pressure up, heart rate up, temperature up, and they are stiffer than a board with an arched back. So how do we treat it? Dantrolene and bromocriptine are options. This is rare, but it's very serious. Most ER nurses have seen cases of this because that's where patients would come for treatment. But know that this is a possibility, and this is a minimum standard that every nurse recognizes what neuroleptic malignant syndrome looks like, and you should know what pharmacological agents we use to treat it. That's why we put them right there for you. Remember this one? The nurse provides care for a patient in ER who's been receiving haloperidol. Which of the following requires an immediate intervention? All right, that last sentence focuses us. We're looking for an immediate intervention. That usually requires something that's wrong or unsafe. So all I know about this patient is we're in the ER and they're on haloperidol. I know that's an antipsychotic, a first generation. So a blood sugar of 70, well, that's normal. I'm not going to intervene with that, so I can get rid of that one. 2+ deep tendon reflexes, and that's normal. So I'm not worried about that. Doesn't need an immediate intervention. Now, picking between these last two, that heart rate seems a little low, so it's not exactly normal, but that temperature is very high. Which one is connected to haloperidol, first-generation antipsychotic? Temperature. That's why the correct answer is C. This may be a sign of impending neuroleptic malignant syndrome. Now, we've got the antipsychotic adverse effects there. They're kind of all over the map, but make sure you take some time to spend looking at that and reviewing that. That covers what we just talked about in the previous slides. Make sure you know what agranulocytosis means so you'll recognize that when interpreting lab values. The first generations are the original ones, they're the older ones, but they have some specific drug-to-drug interactions that I've listed for you here to make sure you're clear on remembering these. So because they have that sedative hypnotic effect, you definitely don't want to take them with another drug or substance that will potentiate that. So with the first generation antipsych, you don't want to take other CNS depressants or alcohol. It's really going to increase your risk of CNS and respiratory depression. Now, it can impact serum levels, cigarette smoking, integritol, or another two groups you don't want to mix with these. Beta blockers can cause severe low blood pressure. Antidepressants may have increased concentration effects. And SSRIs may cause sudden onset of EPSs. So that's why the second generation is generally a better choice for the patient if it can be effective.